More breaking news tonight. The U.S. believes Russian hackers planted a fake news report that sparked a diplomatic crisis in the Persian Gulf. Back with me now on my panel. So, Evan, let's talk about this. U.S. investigators have uncovered new information on a cyber hack in Qatar that is helping to drive a new Middle East crisis among the U.S.'s closest allies. What more have we learned about who is behind this hack?
Well, that's right, Don. U.S. investigators believe that Russian hackers were behind a cyber breach against the Qatar state news agency. The hackers had planted a false news report that was friendly to Iran and critical of President Donald Trump that is now being used by Saudi Arabia and other U.S. allies as a reason to carry out an economic and political blockade of Qatar. U.S. and Qatar officials tell us that the FBI sent in a team of investigators to Doha to help the Qatari government investigate the alleged hacking incident. And the alleged involvement of Russian hackers would, of course, add to concerns by the U.S. intelligence and law enforcement agencies that Russia continues to try to use some of the same cyber hacking measures on U.S. allies that it used to meddle in the U.S. election in 2016. Now, Qatar, as you know, hosts one of the largest U.S. military bases in the region, and U.S. officials say that the Russian goal here appears to be to cause a rift between the U.S. and its allies in the region, Don.
So is it, the investigators believe it's Russian government or just Russian hackers? Is the government in fact behind this? Is that what they believe?
Right. It's not so clear whether the U.S. has tracked the hackers in this incident to Russian criminal organizations or to the security services that are blamed for the election hacks here in the United States. One official told us that based on past intelligence, however, not much happens in that country without the blessing of the Russian government. As you know, today, President Trump was tweeting criticism of the Qataris that is mirroring what you're hearing from the Saudis and others in the region. In his tweet, the president didn't actually mention the hack, but he voiced support for the regional blockade of Qatar, and he cited Qatari funding for terrorist groups. I should note that the Qataris have rejected those accusations, and the CIA and the FBI both declined to comment for this story, Don.
Michael, Evan just mentioned the president's tweet today, and I'll put it up. He said, during my recent trip to the Middle East, I stated that there can no longer be funding of radical ideology. Leaders pointed to Qatar. Look, so, Michael, it appears President Trump is taking credit for allies cutting off ties, but now it seems he got ahead of himself.
Yeah, look, this is very complicated. But first of all, if this is correct, this would be a classic example, maybe the preeminent example of fake news really influencing public policy, world diplomacy, and threatening military confrontation. And that is at a level far beyond anything we've been talking about when we talk about fake news here in the United States. But the other point is, if this again can be traced back to Russian government hackers, and that's a key point, it is also a vivid illustration that whatever steps were taken by the Obama administration in those last few months to try to retaliate or respond to the election hack, and whatever the Trump administration has done, not much in this area, mm-hmm. nothing has worked. The Russians would seem to be unimpeded, and the responses to date have been ineffective. And if that's the case, then we really got to rethink what our cyber strategy is vis-a-vis the Russians.
And Tara, we were just reporting not too long ago, a week or two ago, that there was some fake news that influenced James Comey's decision about the Hillary Clinton investigation as well.
Right, and this is the issue. And fake news has been used to even influence our president as well, as Politico has reported that some of his aides have actually put stories in front of him because he doesn't use a computer and he doesn't actually look through blogs himself, that they're printed out and given to him. And he's been influenced by articles that were presented to him, and some of them not exactly factual. So it's not just a matter of influencing officials. It's been used to influence our own president. And I think there needs to be a real, you know, clarification between what is legitimate news and what is not. And, you know, and the problem is that the president keeps throwing around this word fake news, and people are becoming more and more confused, and people are using it against him at the same time.
Yeah, I think people are confused as to exactly what fake news is. So, David, you have to wonder whether the president, you know, is he being briefed on these matters before, you know, he makes a comment on them, or before he's taken to Twitter?
Well, we know the president's being briefed, but
how
that briefing impacts what he puts out on Twitter is not at all clear. And we should make clear for our viewers that what Michael was just talking about and what you're talking about fake news possibly having this kind of impact, this is not the definition of fake news that Donald Trump uses when he hits the mainstream media.
Donald Trump's definition of fake news is anything that's not glowing or positive about him.
Exactly.
Right. It's this program,
that is not,
Don.
We're actually talking about what is the real fake news problem. And go back to what Evan reported, Don, which is just really intriguing if you look at the president's tweet now, because if indeed these Russian hackers who were creating this fake news, their goal, as Evan was saying, was to drive this wedge between the Qataris and others in the Middle East. Well, Donald Trump played right into that with the tweet. He sort of aided and abetted their effort in doing that, driving a wedge between our own partners in the region. It is an odd moment of tweeting of his, to say the least.
Okay, so Tara.
I was going to say, I just think it shows you how impulsive his tweets are. I mean, we know that he often dictates them to staff, literally down to the capitalization of the words.
But I think you're going where I want to ask you the question, and so then you can weigh in. Because remember, last night we were discussing whether whether it was the official record, whether it was policy, his tweets, or what have you. And then Sean Spicer said today that it was. They are official. They're straight from the president. So if they're official, okay, so that's what they say, but can they be treated as accurate then, Tara? Because they're not always accurate. Most of the time, they aren't.
Right, and we saw that with the misspelling from the prior tweet, which was just a late night tweet that was, you know, fired off. But
or about the mayor of London and on and on, or about the president wiretapping Trump Tower. Go on.
It shows an impulsiveness. It shows the president just acting on his gut, which helped him in the campaign. But, you know, governing is very different than the campaign. And also, I mean, it's not on White House proclamation. So I think in a way they're trying to skirt around that. But now, you know, that little Twitter check mark is basically the same thing that says it's verified. It's coming from the president of the United States. You're getting his thoughts. And you're also realizing that a lot of the statements he's making, not just on Twitter, but to people personally, perhaps world leaders, maybe isn't as informed. I mean, if he's tweeting it off to the whole world, I mean, how much is he actually carrying on that isn't informed? Like we saw with the classified information he passed on to the Russian ambassador. I mean, he didn't know that it was classified information, as we were told, but it's just showing you how he feels so confident with information and maybe isn't as concerned about if it's factual or not, which is brings us all back to the fake news bit.
Fascinating. Thank you all. I appreciate
Thank
it.
You. Yep.